and Procter & Gamble. Well, they're going to be releasing the broadcast series this afternoon in order that we may bring you a description of the World Series baseball game. The Octodoll Ma Perkins program, usually heard at 3:15, will be presented at 4:45 o'clock in September. This is Ty Tyson speaking from Apollo Ground in New York. For the third consecutive year, the play-by-play description of all the World Series games are brought to you with the compliments of the Ford Motor Company, Mr. Henry Ford, Mr. Edco Ford, and your local Ford and Lincoln Zephyr dealers. The National Broadcasting Company Network program this afternoon, and assisting in the broadcast is Tom Manning of WTAM Cleveland, who will give the first 4.5 innings play-by-play account. Then I will follow with that description. But before the game and later on and undoubtedly during the playing of the game, you will hear from Warren Brown, Chicago Herald Examiner, sports feature writer. Mr. Brown is right here now and ready to tell you what's going on out there. Warren Brown.
Thank you. And before we start telling what's going on here now, since this is the first game of the 1936 World Series, I think we ought to go back a little bit into history, particularly because this is an all-New York proposition that we're confronted with here today. Baseball is peculiarly constructed with the New York viewpoint. It was in New York, at Cooperstown, that Abner Doubleday first originated the game of baseball. That was a long time ago, in 1839. Then it was in New York in 1845 that the first club was organized. That was the old Knickerbocker. Again, in 1846, the first game was played, first baseball game. But the boys that played in 1846 had to leave New York. They went over to Hoboken, where the Knickerbockers beat a team called New York 23-1 in four innings. Of course, by our 1936 standards, four innings would not constitute a ball game, and the customers would have to get the rain checks and come back for another time. But that game, the first one in 1846, was probably as exciting to the few people that witnessed it as will be these games which begin here this afternoon. Now, getting into our World Series history, World Series, as such, have been going on since 1903. The first one was played between the Boston Red Sox and the Pittsburgh National League. Seven of these World Series down through the ages have played to more than $1 million in cash. The first one, oddly enough, was the one whose anniversary we are celebrating today, a meeting between the Yanks and the Giants. It's just 13 years ago since the Yanks and Giants met in World Series play before. That series also witnessed the departure of the Yankees from the Polo Grounds for the first time. That was the year that the Yankee Stadium was open, the stadium known as the place that Ruth built. And the Yanks and Giants alternated across the Harlem River, as they are going to do in this series. The 1923 World Series was also the first one that was ever broadcast. The 1923 World Series was won by the New York Yankees, four games out of six. And the consensus of experts seems to be that this series is going to go four games out of six. I'm not giving that as my opinion. Of course, I'm merely reporting what I read in the paper. The Yankees, it seems to me, have been peculiarly mixed up with records in World Series. Their winner's share of a series between the Yankees and the St. Louis Cardinals in 1926 was the largest for each man that has ever been taken out of a World Series play. Perhaps it would be well to mention the fact that the players participating in the World Series game share in proceeds of the first four games of a series. In 1926, the winning share of the St. Louis Cardinals who beat the Yankees was $6,100. It has been expected that this series between the Giants and the Yankees this year will come very close to equaling that World Series record of individual money. The Polo Grounds is more or less built in the shape of a horseshoe that is almost closed at the end in center field. That means that the foul lines on either side of the field are not very long. The foul line in left field will run about 300 feet from the home plate, and the foul line in right field is even shorter than that, being approximately 290 feet from the home plate. Down through the years, baseball writers have made a great deal over pop fly home runs in the polo ground. And since the Yankees come into this series with more home run records than was ever deemed possible since Babe Ruth went away, people have been thinking that there will be a lot of home runs in here. Because of the way the polo ground's outfield in both right and left curve away after they pass the foul line, it has seemed to me over a period of years that the hits balance themselves up pretty well. And while there are a lot of the pop fly home runs that drop into the stand close by the foul line, there are also a lot of long flies that are hit to deep right and deep left that do not go for home runs here that would be circuit wallops almost in any other ballpark in the country. And we are broadcasting from a spot directly in back of the home plate. This World Series of 1936 has taken on a peculiar significance because of the amazing drive the Giants made during the closing stages of their own race to win. The Yankees, of course, overpowered the American League, and their lead was never in danger from the middle of the season. If then, they simply coasted in the victory. The Giants are out to break what is a unique record in World Series history. The last three World Series that have occupied the attention of the New York Yankees have found them winning in four straight games. In 1927, they defeated Pittsburgh four straight. In 1928, they defeated St. Louis four straight. And in 1932, they defeated Chicago four straight. Now they're playing the Giants. That means to say that the New York Yankees, including this, in their last four World Series ventures, will have played the four outstanding teams in the National League over the period of years. The contending teams in the National League have invariably been one of those four. Now, Ty, I think I'll turn this back to you and let you warm up your vocal cords.
Well, here we are for the lineup. Well, much of this is in the polo ground. The Giants are the home team, so we'll give you the visiting team first, the Yankees. Frank Rossetti, shortstop. Red Rolfe, third base. Joe DiMaggio, center field. Lou Gehrig, first base. Bill Dickey, catcher. Jake Powell, left field. Tony Lazzari, second base. George Selkirk, right field. Charlie Ruffing, pitcher. The Giants just took the field. For the Giants, Joe Moore, left field. Dick Bartell, shortstop. Bill Terry, first base. Mel Ott, right field. Jim Ripple, center field. Judge Mancuso, catcher. Burgess Whitehead, second base. Travis Jackson, third base. And Carl Hubble, pitcher. National anthem, everybody up.
Off the field. It won't be long now until Carl Hubble and the famous screwball. expected a victory. Finish the season with that string still on board.
No, he pitched a great game the last time he appeared in the World Series, and I don't believe that we've ever been at a World Series where the entire town is so sold on one individual. They say it's New York Yankees against the strong left arm of Carl Hubbell. Well, we'll soon know. At the moment, Bill Terry, Hill Phillips, been nursing a bad knee over half the season. He's limping across the field now, running over to have a last-moment conference with the umpires and his field captain, Patrick Jackson. There seems to be something in the way down on the left field foul line. Another right field foul line, 294 feet from home plate. It's clamped out then about 30 feet away. It's 339 feet. What a tremendous smash it is into deep right center. It's 455 feet away. From home plate, right to second base, on out to center. It is 483 feet. Those same dimensions are prevalent in left field. About 449 feet directly to left field, and then that big billboard glimmers along till it's 315 feet right on the line. So you can see the tremendous hitters of the Giants and the Yankees. If they can keep those drives close to the foul line, a lot of things are going to happen. The first hitter for the New York Yankees, another Giants of the home team this afternoon. We're at the Polo Grounds. First two games here. The New York Yankees in their gray uniforms, trimmed in dark blue stockings, blue caps. They are the visiting team. Frank Cosetti will be the first hitter. By the way, he learned to play ball on a family ranch out in Los Gatos, California. He was born in San Francisco October 4th, 1910. And after a brilliant career with the Seals, he was bought for the New York club for $75,000. Umpire Cy Fierman behind the plate. Gus Mancuso holds his fist. He's holding it in the air. Just a gesture of encouragement to the New York Giants. The umpire's a foul play ball. Gus Mancuso squatting down, giving the first signal to Carl Hubbell. And it'll only be a second now until the Classic of 1936 will be underway. Hubbell starts to wind up. And here's the pitch. It's a ball, a fast ball that just hits the outside corner on Frank Cosetti, a right-hand batter. World Series is on. We're at the Polo Grounds in New York, and the first pitch is ball one, low outside. Frank Cosetti, the batter, and Red Rolfe hanging around. Here it comes. It's a bounding ball down third. Jackson has it. The play is good, and he is out. And, of course, you heard the enthusiasm after that play, the first out. Yes, the World Series is really on. Now we have Red Rolfe coming up. Red is quite a ball player, a left-hand hitter. Here's the windup, one away, nobody on. It's a strike. What a beautiful curve ball. That ball seemed to literally sweep, almost hit the first base cushion, and then bend over that plate. You know what I mean? It's a strike. No. There's the stretch, and here it is. It's a strike. Now waving and roaring here. Very close to 45,000, I believe, before the game gets very much further along. Perhaps close to 50,000 will be here this afternoon. The count on Red Ross, the second man up, is strike two. First inning, one man out, nobody on. The windup. It's a ball. The count is strike two and ball one. Carl Hubbell having an advantage on Rolfe, the batter, to that base ball high outside. Now the count is strike two and ball one. One out and nobody out. As a bounding ball down first, Bill Terry has it. He makes the play unassisted. Two men out. Terry then whips the ball to Gus Mancuso, to Jackson, to Whitehead, to Bartell. And now the boys, the Giants, in their white uniforms, are surrounded the pitcher's box. Encouraging each other. You know, that's the game that's foremost in Bill Terry's mind, to encourage those Giants. That's what he's been doing all year. Now we have two outs, nobody on, and perhaps the greatest recruit that has come to the Major League in a long time, steps to the back. It's Joe DiMaggio. Joseph Paul DiMaggio Jr. I love it, the folks out there on the coast like that. Here's the pitch. He hits the first ball at the bounder down short. Bartell comes up with it. The play. The throw was wide to Bill Terry. Left the bag, grabbed the ball, and it was close at first, but Harry Geist had called him up. No runs, no hits, and no errors. What did you think of that first inning, Tom?
I think it impressed me most in the first inning, Tom. The fact that Bubble was pitching to the three first batters to face him, pitched but one ball above the belt.
We've read a lot about how these Giant pitchers were going to throw nothing but downers to the Yankee batters, and Buff looks as though that's what he's going to do. In the pitches that he served up that inning, only one ball was pitched above the belt.
He has a fine breaking curve, which he showed there to Red Rolf. I doubt if Red has seen such a break all season long in the American League. Now here come the Giants in for their turn at bat. Joe Moore walking up there to the plate while Ruffing is talking through to Bill Dickey. And I guess you better take it there. Joe's a left-hand hitter, so it doesn't take him very long to get up there.
You know, it's Big Red Ruffing, one of the biggest pitchers in the major league. Red has had a grand year out here for the Yankees. He's a great hitter. Behind the bat, they have Bill Dickey. Bill has had perhaps one of the greatest seasons in his career. He batted 362. Bill, they say, is brittle. He was able to stay in there practically all year, thereby enabling the New York Yankees to win the American League by more games than any other team in the history of baseball. In the last half of the first inning.
And Joe Moore, the little left fielder, who had a batting average of 318, will lead off. The Giants, you know, white suit with light blue trimming. Red Ruffing gets the signal. He's a right-hander. And here it is. It's a fly ball going out into left field. Left fielder is under it and has it. That is Jake Powell playing left field this afternoon for the Yankees. Joe Moore hit a fly ball to medium left field, and we have one gone. The Yankees have played a lot of pepper after that ball was tossed back to the infield, and they whipped it around, almost knocking each other over. Now we have Dick Bartell, shortstop, coming up, getting 298 for the season. Strike one, swinging. And the roar of the crowd goes up because he did take a mighty swing at that first ball pitch. Last half of the first inning, one out, nobody on. Strike one. Ball one. That was a nice hook ball that went to the outside corner. And the count on Dick Bartell is ball one and strike one. We'll have Memphis Bill Terry, the manager of the Giants, coming up next. Bartell, the hitter, ball one, and the strike one. Charlie Ruffing, Red Ruffing, winds up. There's a drive out of the left center field. It's a long way out. Powell going over under it. He has it. That ball was hit right on the nose into deep left center field, almost 400 feet from home plate. But Jakey Powell was playing deep and dashed over, made the catch, and now we have two men out. Listen to that round of applause for Bill Terry. No, Memphis Bill did a grand job of bringing the Giants into the National League pennant this year. They were sort of down in the mouth in this season, down in fifth place. But then they started, and here they are. Memphis Bill batting left-handed. It's a ball inside. Memphis Bill had to duck out of the way of that one, and I noticed that he was favoring that injured knee of his. Last half of the first inning, two men out, nobody on. Windup. It's a bounding ball out in the center field, and it's a base hit. A single for Bill Terry. The ball was retrieved by center fielder Joe DiMaggio. Returned to Tony Lazzari at second, and Memphis Bill has opened the Blue Ribbon Classic of 1936 with the first base hit. It was a ground ball that Frank Rossetti, the Yankee shortstop, go for and failed to negotiate the stop, and it's a base knock for Bill Terry. Now we have Mel Ott coming up. Mel Ott, you know, broke in to the National League at the age, tender age of 17, under the late John J. McGraw. He's a great favorite here at the Polo Grounds, and he should be. He's a grand ball player. Right, ball. Last half of the first inning, two outs. Bill Terry is on first, and Mel Ott, the Giant right fielder, left-hand hitter, is up. Foul ball, up and back, and it's strike two. Mel had a very good season, being among the leading home run hitters and compiling a grand batting average of 328. Always find Mel Ott up among the leading hitters of the National League. The picture again, last half of the first, no score. Bill Terry on first, two men out, Mel Ott is up. Strike two, the pitch, hit
a ball. Fat ball high outside, and the count is strike two and ball one. Dolly roughing out, kicking that dirt around out there in the pitcher's box, taking plenty of time. Perhaps that's a bit of strategy and worrying the hitter. Anyway, the count is strike two and ball one. Now he's back in the box with his foot on the rubber. The stretch. Strike two, ball one. Ball two. That was a snappy, fast breaking curveball. Just hit the outside corner to Mellon, a left-hand batter. Now the count is two and two. Last half of the first inning of this old World Series ball game at the Polo Grounds in New York. No score as yet. Two out, Bill Kelly on first. And two and two on the hitter. Here it is. It's a ball. Ball three and strike two on Mellon. The pitcher, Mellon, steps out of the batter's box. Gets a little handful of dirt. Rubs it on his hand. Now he steps in the box. Takes a hitch in his trousers. Does that count three and two? You know this one has got to be in. Here it is. Ball four. With the count three and two, Charlie Ruffing attempted to force Bell up and shot in a curve ball. The ball was coming over the plate, but both low inside. Mellon stepped away, and now we have Mellon on first. Manager Bill Perry on second. And Ripple. Ripple, R-I-P-P-L-E. Center fielder coming up. Ripple has a batting average of 306 for the season. He too, like Mellon, is a left-hand batter. There's the stretch and the pitch. All one. Sharp breaking curveball was over the plate, just a little bit high. Last half of the first inning, no score as yet. Two men out and two men on. Ripple the batter and the pitch. It's a strike. Ball. A burning fastball right down the center and about belt high. But Ripple has elected to work the string out a little further. He takes it and it's strike one and ball one. There's the signal again and Ruffing takes the stretch and here it is. It's a ball. A fastball with low inside. Ripple stepping back. And now the count is ball two and strike one. This is not particularly out of the ordinary for Charlie Ruffing. Charlie, you know, has started a lot of his games this year by being just a little bit wild. He has been able to settle down and compile a fine season pitching record. It's ball two and strike one. Two out. Runners on first and second. And the pitch. A swing. He misses. And it's strike two. Ripple really swung at that ball. Now it's two and two. Last half of the first inning, and nobody has scored as yet. Bill Carey on second. Mellon is on first. Two men out. There's the stretch. Two and two. Here it is. He swings at the foul. Up over third base. Now remains 2-2. That ball fell into a crowd of spectators. Too many of the boys, too many fingers in the pie, and they knocked it back out on the field, which brought a roar from the crowd. The count remains ball two and strike two.
Charlie Ruffing is going to take a bit of time before delivering that next one. Now he's on the rubber. Draws his pitching hand across the letters on his shirt, and then the stretch. 2-2 the pitch. Ball three. Ripple. Took almost a half swing at that ball, changed his mind, and just broke wide of the plate to a left-hand hitter. There's a full count of three and two, and Mellon and Bill Carey, of course, will be off with the pitcher's motion. George Selkirk is playing just a little bit deeper for Ripple than usual, the left-hand hitter. Here it is. There it is. It's a high fly ball in back of third base. Frank Gozzetti under it. He has it. And that is all for the Giants. No runs, one hit.
Come inside. The first inning reflected the, to me, reflected the pitching of both clubs. In other words, with Carl Hubble pitching his downer, as they call it, the Yankees went out in order on balls hit on the ground. While Ruffing had the Giants popping him in the air. first two men, Moore and Bartel, flying out to right to left field. And Ripple ending the inning with a pop-up. Frankie Crosetti, who moved over behind third base to make the cut. All right, Tom.
No scores yet, and the mighty Larrabing Lou Gehrig of Columbia. Lou, you know, is a great favorite here in New York. He should be. He's played grand baseball for them. He has that great average of consecutive games. And in his younger days, Lou, of course, was a great star, a great football player and baseball player over Columbia. So it's Larrabing Columbia Lou coming up to the plate for the first time. As you can take it from me, there's a bit of excitement in the hearts of these rooters at the Polo Ground. It's Kyle Hubbell against the great Lou Gehrig, the mighty left-hand hitter. He's taking no chances, and here's the first pitch. As a bounding ball down second base way, but Terry goes over, takes it, tosses to Hubbell. A brilliant play by both Bill Terry and Kyle Hubbell. Terry was playing a deep first base for Lou Gehrig. As that ball was hit between first and second, Terry elected to go over and field the ball, and Hubbell was alert, dashed over, took the peg, and Gary declared at first base, Terry to Hubbell. One out. And now another mighty hitter, who can boast of a batting average of .362 for the past season. It is Bill Dixon, one of the tallest catchers of all time.
And what a grand season Bill Dickey has had in the American League this year. Hubbell winds up. Has a bounding ball through the box. Whitehead comes over fast, takes it, the throw, he's out. That was a slow, high bounding ball that Burgess Whitehead ambled in for and took belt high and then snapped it over to Bill Terry at first. And Gary and Dickey have been retired. Two outs, nobody on. And J.G. Powell coming up. Powell, you know, came over from Washington in that trade, except the speedy Ben Chapman to the Senator. Take Powell, a right-hand batter. Two outs, nobody on. All one. Sharp breaking curve ball just a little bit outside. Powell, you know, when he broke into the American League, he was very, very fast on his feet and still is. I don't see him, however, as fast as Chapman. Ball one. Ball two. Carl Hubbell used that old screwball, as he called it that time. Came up to the plate almost as big as a watermelon, but it was outside, and it's ball two. First half of the second inning, and no score as yet. Yankees back, nobody on, and we have two men out. Carl Hubbell again winds up. It's a strike. That one split the plate right in half. But with the count 2-1, Powell decided to work out the string. A slight drizzle beginning to fall here at the Polo Grounds at the moment. I don't believe, however, that it's going to interfere with the game immediately. It's a ball. Nice sharp breaking curve ball with a low inside. Powell takes it, and now the count is ball three and strike one. Carl Hubbell pitching and Gus Mancuso catching. Here it is. The foul up on the screen and back of home plate. And we find Jake Powell with a full count of ball three and strike two. Ball three and strike two. You notice the Hubbell is working just a little bit slower than is Charlie Ruffing. Sends over and now the windup with a count 3-2. A foul back and the count remains. Ball three and strike two. From our lofty perch here in the press box, we look out over center field, directly through center field, and we see the home of the Yankees. That's where the third, fourth, and fifth game, if necessary, will be played. Right smack through center field. Ready to go again. First half of the second inning. The American League Yankees are in back. Two outs, nobody on. Jake Powell at bat with a full count of three and two. And here it is. As a line drive, it's a base knock into left center field. Ball is received out there by Ripple. Return to the infield where it is taken by Bartel. And Jake Powell gets the first Yankee hit of the first game of this 1936 Blue Ribbon Classic at the Polo Grounds in New York. A line smash that went into left center field and was fielded very cleanly by center fielder Ripple and returned to the infield. Now we have Tony Lazzari coming up.
Tony Lizzeri, the Yankee second baseman and a right-hand batter. Center fielder and right fielder have moved back just a little bit. As a play at first base. Just a gesture on the part of Hubble. Because Powell was not very far off.
Here it is. It's a strike. Nice curve ball right over the heart of the plate. Guy Fairman called it, and the count ends 1-0 on Lizzeri. Strike one. First half of the second inning, no score as yet. There's the stretch of Hubble. The pitch. Outside. I saw Bartel start over to second. That apparently was a pitch out on the part of the Giants. Now the count is ball one and strike one. That pitch out, you know, for those not so familiar with baseball, a signal for the catcher. He thought that perhaps Powell was going down and called for a wide ball. So there'd be no obstruction in his way for the play at second. One and one. Another play at first base. Powell gets back very fast. No chance at all of getting him. Lizzeri is up. Ball one, strike one. Ball two. That was a curve ball. It was over the plate, but just a little bit low. And the count now is ball two and strike one. Ball two and strike one on Tony Lizzeri, a right-hand batter. Hubble takes a stretch again. Two outs. Powell on first. It's a foul strike. The count on Tony Lizzeri is ball two and strike two. I believe that foul may have hit Gus Mancuso on the back of his glove. Not making any to-do about it, but he did take his catching mitt off and rub the hand for a moment. He is not hurt. We're ready to go. It's ball two and strike two. Jake Powell on first with two up. Here it is. Ball three.
That downer pitch of his, because he caused the first two men, Gehrig and Bill Dickey, to ground out, as the first three in the first inning did. And Jackie Powell got a hold of one that was pitched about waist high, but he singled into left center field. Tony Lizzeri up there with three and two, looked at a very sharp breaking curve about knee high over the inside corner for the called third strike. Each team has made one hit so far. Giants have placed two runners on base. They've had two left on base. And the Yankees won. We go into the last half of the second inning. Just Mancuso is up, Tom. Oh, there he is.
We're going into the last half of the second inning. The National League Giants coming to bat. And Gus Mancuso, the Giant catcher and the right-hand hitter, is up. The pitcher is roughing it. Here we go. There's a smash to right field. It's foul in the upper deck. Strike one.
Well, the fans over here along first base got a little thrill out of that one. That was fouled by not too much. No score as yet as we play the last half of the second inning. Charlie Ruffing and Bill Dickey, the strong point for the Yankees. Ball one. That's a sharp breaking curve ball. It was plenty low and outside. Count on Gus Mancuso, ball one and strike one. Gus Mancuso has been a great spark plug of the Giants this year. Ball one and strike one. Strike two. Yes, sir. Gus Mancuso was swinging for the old Yankee Stadium that time. Swung from way back, you know. Strike two and ball one. Last half of the second inning, and so far we have a scoreless tie. Strike two and ball one. It's a foul back to Constance. Remains unchanged. First. Strike two and ball one. Gus Mancuso stepped out of the box for a moment. Now he's back in there. Ruffing has his glove off and fondling that ball for a moment. It's strike two. Ball one. Now the windup. High foul over third base. Ross coming over. It's close to the stands. He dove into the boxes. He just barely had his fingertips on that ball. Dove into the boxes, unable to hold it, and the count is strike two and ball one. Umpire Bill Summers is going over there fast. On the way over, Ross lost his cap. Fans, too, were very courteous over there. They stepped aside and allowed Ross to
5 for the cut. Walt was just slightly bumped on that attempt. Frank Rossetti in short runs over, talks to him for a moment, but he is not unhurt. Just guard a little bit, and we're ready to go. Rain is coming down just a little bit harder. Not really a rain, just a drizzle. It's not very warm here at the Polo Grounds in New York this afternoon. That didn't stop the crowd from this Blue Ribbon Classic. Right to ball one. It's a foul back. That ball hit Bill Dickey on the right hand, and he's shaking his hand. He's holding his bare hand in back of him. The boys are walking in for a moment, but I do not believe that his fingers would split or anything. No, he is close to the back of their position. However, bumping the pitcher and red ball continue their stretch to home plate. Now they return to their position. Bill Dickey is still shaking that hand. A tip foul. That's backing a little bit on the throwing net. Boy, that'd be a tough break for the cause of the American League. Strike two and ball one. Ruffin pitching, and Hugo batting, and we're ready again. It's a called strike, and Hugo didn't like that for a moment, but it's a called strike. You know, there's something about an umpire decision. The fellow once said, you may be down, but you're never out. But when the umpire says you're out, there's no argument. One gone and nobody on. Now we have Burgess Whitehead coming up. Hit the ball, a fast ball inside. Now it's 1-0. Last half of the second. One man out and nobody out. Ball back. Ball one and strike one.
No chance of Dyke Tyson. Yours really getting hit with those balls this afternoon unless they come right through that screen. I don't see that that's possible. First time in a good many years we've been able to work it back to the screen. All right, ball one and strike one. Last half of the second, one out and nobody on. Ruffing winds up. It's a foul. Back. Strike one and ball one. Tony Lazzari is running in from his second base position now into the box to say something to his pitcher, Charlie Ruffing. Bill Dickey is still as that throwing hand clinched. He walked around home plate while that little conference was going on between Tony Lazzari and Ruffing. Ruffing now is walking toward home plate. He's called Bill Dickey out. He's walked within 10 or 15 feet of home plate. The boys perhaps discovered some little inside dope on one of the players or something. Some of the fans now apparently adherents of the Giants are yelling at them to get going. Last half of the second, you know, no score as yet. One man out. Burgess Whitehead, the second baseman, is up, and it's strike two and ball one. Here we go again. It's a bounding ball down short, a big hop. Rossetti has it. The throw to Gehrig, and he's out. All of these grounders this afternoon have taken very beautiful hops. Boys have not had to trap them. They've most of them about belt high. Travis Jackson, the captain of the Giants, is coming to bat. Travis Jackson has long been a favorite here in Harlem. And this afternoon, the fans acknowledge it by giving him a nice round of applause as he comes to the plate for the first time. Two outs, nobody on the pitch. Strike. What a beautiful curveball Ruffing shot him that time. That is easily the prettiest curve ball that he has caught this afternoon. It had plenty of smoke on it and very sharp. Strike one. Ball one. That was a curve ball too, but it broke low and outside, and the count is ball one and strike one. Last half of the second, two out and nobody on. Travis Jackson. Jackson's a right-hand batter. Strike. He swings hard and misses. And the count is strike two and ball one. Travis Jackson is a long left field hitter, and for that reason, Powell is playing just a bit deeper than usual. Wind up, strike two, ball one. Strike three, Powell. That was a nice curve ball that caught the outside corner of the plate for a called strike, and that's all for the Giants in the second inning. No runs,
no hits and no errors.
Tomorrow will be October 1st, the opening of the Ford dealer's nationwide used car clearance sale. More than 150,000 good used cars and trucks will be sold by Ford dealers during October at bargain prices. Well, that second inning, as far as the Giants are concerned, Ruffing seemed to pitch considerably better than he did in the first inning, or possibly the opposition wasn't quite so strong, because both Mancuso and Travis Fan and Burgess Whitehead got an easy bounder to Frank Rossetti at shortstop. So far, the pitchers have dominated this game, and the result is it hasn't been necessary for any fielders to come up with any hard play.
Coming into this third inning, while it's still drizzling a little bit, doesn't seem to be getting any worse than it has been, and I think we'll be able to do at least five innings, don't you think, Tom? Better get them up there fast.
Going into the first half of that third inning, again the American League comes to bat. Scoreless tie, you know. Very few seats vacant here at the Polo Grounds. The panorama of humanity that one would travel a long distance to see. And we're not disappointed this afternoon. The American flag flying aloft and the cutting hanging over the upper deck. It's a real pretty picture. Ready to go. We have Selkirk. Left-hand batter up at the strike. Ball. First half of the third inning and the Yankees come to bat. Selkirk had a batting average this year of 308. There's a long smash, it's going, high up in the stands in right field. It's a home run for George Selkirk. A home run, a mighty smash by the right fielder of the New York Yankees, and the scoreless tie has been broken. Boy, what a smash. He has been at home plate by Cosetti and Ruffing. They're waving their bats. They give him a pat on the back. And Bill Ferry has walked to the pitcher's box. Boy, oh boy, what a smash. Well, that's that. You know by the roar of the crowd that the Yankees have a lot of rooters. But anybody would yell over that one. Charlie Ruffing is up. He swings hard, pops the ball. Hubble picks it up, it's close, he is out. Scotty Ruffing swung hard at the first ball pitch. He popped it, and Hubble didn't make up his mind for a moment to pick that one up. He did not hesitate too long, picked it up just in time, and threw it to Perry at first for the out. One gone. Frank Rossetti coming up for the second time. Frank Rossetti is a right-hand batter. First half of the third inning, the American League is one, National League nothing. One out, nobody on, and Frank Rossetti, the Yankee shortstop, and the right-hand batter at the plate, and Carl Hubble winds up. He hits the first ball. It's a very high fly ball in back of second with Whitehead backing up, waving the others away. He makes the catch. Now we have two men out. Boy, that baby Selkirk really stepped into that ball shot up there by Hubble, and he did not park it in the lower stand, but he parked it in the upper deck. And if you think that is a real massy shot, come on out to the Polo Grounds and try it. Boy, oh boy, what a club. Two men out. Nobody on. Red Wall, third base, the left-hand hitter is up.
Well, the boys here in the box tell me that that's only the eighth home run that has been hit off the pitching Carl Hubble this year. Two men out, nobody on, off the batter, left-hander, and here's the pitch. That's a bounding ball between first and second. It's a big hit. The ball is received by Carl Ott. Ott returns the ball to Martell at second, and Carl stops at first base. Redwell's got a nice man for that base hit. It's a fast bounding ball between first and second. Bill Terry and Burgess Whitehead both went after the ball, but neither of them could touch it. It went on to Bellock, and it's a base knock. Now Joe DiMaggio is coming up. Again, the fans on the edge of their seats. They're watching who's coaching too. He's a great favorite all in one year. What a sensation he has been. Yes, he has a batting average in his first year of 324. That's something. They're ready to go. He hit
at the first ball. It's a base hit out into right field. Rawls is rounding second. Rawls was on his way to third. He fell down after touching second and stood along and had to go back to second base. It's a single. Out there, and Redloff in rounding second base, it keeps himself from under him, fell down, rolled along, and just barely got up on his feet and trying to get back to second base, back up.
And the right-hand batter at the plate, and Paul Hubbell winds up. He hits the first ball. It's a very high fly ball in back of second with Whitehead backing up, waving the others away. He makes the catch. Now we have two men out. Boy, that baby Selkirk really stepped into that ball shot up there by Hubbell, and he did not park it in the lower stand, but he parked it in the upper deck. And if you think that is a real match he's got, come on out to the Polo Grounds and try it. Boy, oh boy, what a club. Two men out. Nobody on. Redloff, third base, the left-hand hitter is up.
One of the boys here in the box tell me that that's only the eighth home run and it's been hit off the 15th Carl Hubbell this year. Two men out, nobody on. Ross the batter, left-hander, and here's the pitch. That's a bounding ball between first and second. It's a base hit. The ball is received by Melvin Ott. Ott returns the ball to Martell at second, and Ross stops at first base. Redloff got a nice hand for that base hit. It was a fast bounding ball between first and second. Bill Terry and Burgess Whitehead both went after the ball, but neither of them could touch it. It went on to well out, and it's a base knock. Now Joe DiMaggio is coming up. Again, the fans are on the edge of their seats. They're watching who's supposed to shoot. He's a great favorite all in 1 year. What a great base that he has been. Yes, he has a batting average in his first year up to 24. That's something. We're ready to go. He hits the first ball. It's a base hit out into right field. Rolf is rounding second. Rolf was on his way to third. He fell down after touching second and slid along and had to go back to second base. It's a single. It's getting just a little bit slippery out there. And Redloff in rounding second base. It keeps himself from under him. Fell down, rolled along, and just barely got up on his feet and trying to get back to second before Tazzy tagged up. Now we have the mighty Lou Gehrig of the Yankees coming up. And the fans are all yelling. The crowd seems about evenly divided. The Giants and Jets, you know, haven't given folks much chance to yell for them. That home run of the Yankees has seemed to break their rooters up, and now they're rooting for Gehrig to get one. Here's the first pitch. It's a strike. A beautiful curveball was coming at Gehrig and then broke over the plate, and it's a strike. First time up, and also that first pitch to Gehrig, it's been a slow, sweeping curveball. Two outs, you know. Ralph is on second. Joe DiMaggio on first. DiMaggio has a big lead. Ball one. That was a burning fastball right at the head of Gehrig. Gehrig just nodded a bit and stepped out of the way, and it is strike one and ball one. Yes, it is still drifting. That field is becoming a little bit slippery out there. Ball one, strike one. Gehrig is back. The fans on the edge of their seats. The runners on first and second and two outs. There's the stretch. Ball one and strike one. The pitch. It's a strike. A strike ball. Strike two and ball one. Again, Carl Hubbell keeps that sweeping curve ball. That one, I think, was just a little bit faster than the other two. Now we'll see whether or not Carl Hubbell attempts to pull the string on Gehrig. If he does, anything can happen. Either way, for the Yanks and for the Giants. But anyway, this is the spot. Strike two and ball one. There's a stretch. Here it is. The founder back to Hubbell. Hubbell takes it and crosses his turn. I believe on that ball with a count strike two and ball one. The players are all set for a back ball.
instead of that Paul Hubbell tossed up a full sweeping curve that was as big as a mullet, and Gehrig, out of the turn, attempts to hold the swing and just barely tapped the ball and went back to Hubbell. Hubbell, he carries for the out.
Keeping the Yankees rather handcuffed during the first two innings, George Selkirk came through to blast that one in the upper deck to put the Yanks in the lead, 1-0. Then after Ruffing and Crocetti had been retired, Rolfe and DiMaggio came along with singles, and it looked as though Huff might be in for a bad inning. However, as Tom just told you, Hubbell crossed Gehrig on that last pitch, which resulted in a very easy bounder right back to the box on which Gehrig was retired and which retired the side. So it's 1-0 in favor of the Yanks as we go into the last half of the third inning.
That round of applause is for Carl Hubbell. Carl Hubbell gets a nice round of applause from all of the fans here at the Polo Grounds in New York as he steps up to the plate. Carl Hubbell, you know, pitches them left-handed, but bats them right-handed. They have Charlie Ruffing, a right-hander in the box for the Yanks, with Bill Dickey receiving. And it's Hubbell and Mancuso for the National League. Here we go with the last half of the third. The score, Yankees 1, Giants nothing. Strike. Carl Hubbell swung very hard at that first ball and missed. Getting pretty dark here on the Polo Grounds, still drizzling. There's a base knock. It's a base knock in the center field. Radio friends, I'm stopping after each of those blows so that you too might get the thrill of hearing this enormous crowd here after calling the play for you. We should stop and let our engineers allow you to hear the applause and the thunderous applause, as it were, here in this first exciting game of the World Series. Carl Hubbell with one strike took a ball that was just a little bit above the knees and poked it on a line in the center field. There it was retrieved by DiMaggio and returned to the infield where it was taken by Crosetti. Now we're ready to go, and again we have Joe Moore. Joe Moore, you know, back to left hand. Carl Hubbell has his overcoat on, as it were, all buttoned up, very snug. Charlie Ruffing makes a stretch. It's a strike. Call. Ball one and strike one. Last half of the third inning. Nobody out as yet. Score 1-0 in favor of the Yankees of the American League. Strike. He swings hard and misses. Strike two and ball one. Carl Hubbell on first base. Joe Moore, you know, the left-hand batter of the Giants. Joe's playing left field and playing lots of left field this year. There's the stretch. Hit the ball outside, and the count is now ball two and the strike two. Well, the fans who have the field boxes at the moment are just getting a very nice poke. That drizzle has increased a little bit at the moment. There's been no gestures or suggestions on the part of the officials to call the game as yet, however. Strike two and ball two. It's a foul back. Joe Moore, the left fielder of the Giants, the batter. Ball two and strike two at the count on Joe Moore. Umpire has tossed out a new ball. Charlie Ruffing is having just a bit of difficulty in keeping his pitching hand dry out there in the drizzle. There's the stretch again. Hubbell is on first, you know, with nobody out, and it's 2-2. He swings hard, that ball that went up with a chip ball, and Bill Dickey hung on it for a moment, but then dropped it, and the count remains ball two and strike two. Ball two and strike two. Take a look at the outfield for you. Selkirk is playing a little deep. DiMaggio playing medium, as is Powell. Infield playing in their regular positions, and I believe Mazzari, or rather Crosetti, will take the throw if a play is made at second. Hubbell probably will not attempt to steal.
It's 2-2. Here it is. He swings and misses. Strike three. One gone in the giant half of the third inning. Set count, ball two and strike two. Joe Moore took a mighty cut at a curved ball that was over the outside corner. Just missed it by a little bit in that count. And it's a strikeout. One gone. Dick Bartell, shortstop at bat. On this play, Jake Paul, the left fielder, moves a little bit. Hits the first ball. Big hit. Just inside the right field line. Hubble is rounding second, going to third. The ball is received by Shelker. Returned to Lazzari. And Bartell stops at first. You know, that was a rather funny base that Dick Bartell was laughing down there at first. He attempted to hold that swing a little bit and just poked the ball out into right field over Gary Kent inside the line. That was mighty fast feeling in the part of Selkirk. Well, we've got a ball game on again now with that score 1-0 in favor of the Yankees. We're in the last half of that third inning. One man out, runners on first and third, and Memphis Bill Perry. Still, you know, at the first hit of the afternoon, he opened the base hit. He's a left-hand hitter. Ruffin gets his signal and the stretch. Bartell on first, Hubble on third. The pitch. Ball one. A fast ball. It broke wide of the plate. And the count on Bill Terry was a nothing. Terry has asked umpire Perlin to inspect the ball. He does, but without any inspection or any argument, he tosses out a new one. Last bat of the third inning. 1-0 in favor of the Yankees. The Giants have runners on first and third. Bartell first, Hubble third, and one man out. Terry at bat, and it's ball one. Here it is. Swings, he misses. It's a strike. Ball one, strike one. Manager Bill took a healthy cut at that baby. All right, get on the edge of your seat, you giant booties. Well, here it comes. Ball one, strike one.
It's a foul ball. Not very far away with Wolf and Dickey going back. Dickey is under it. He has it. And as he made that catch, manager Bill Curry took that bat and he slapped it in the dirt and knocked up that stuff there up over his head. He certainly wanted to get a hold of one. That's it. At least a fly ball or something. Shot up a high foul ball that was handled by Bill Dickey. Now, two men out, runners on first and third, and Mellott coming up. It's not all over yet, you know, because Mellott is one of the National League long-distance hitters. For many years, Mellott has been up among the home run hitters of the National League. Bartell is on first, Hubble is on third. Here's the pitch. Ball one. The curve ball is low outside. Bartell is looking around to see whether or not to play it safe. Here's the pitch. Ball two. That one was just a little bit low for Mellott, the left-hand batter, and the count is ball two. The score, you know, New York Yankees. The American League won. And the Giants of the National League nothing. They've reached the last half of the third inning with two men out, runners on first and third. Mellott is at bat, and it's 2-0. Willie or won't he? Here it is. Nope. It's outside. Ball three. I thought that was a very smartly picked ball by Charlie Ruffing with that count 2-0 and runners on first and third. That's usually the spot for the automatic strike. But instead of that, he had a very pretty curve ball. It broke wide of the plate, and it is now 3-0. Ball four. That was high inside, and we have the bases loaded. Mellott is on first. Dick Bartell is on second. Carl Hubble is on third. We have Ripple, center fielder, coming up. Ripple hit 328 this year. He's a left-hand batter. There you have it. The bag loaded. Charlie Ruffing pitching. Bill Dickey catching. Ripple is up. Two men out, and the Giants one run behind. Here's a long windup and the pitch. Strike. A mighty swing into tip foul that is held by Dickey. Strike one. Rain is coming down pretty hard at the moment. But nobody is leaving those box seats. No, sir, not a single one. Here's that pitch. Strike. Ball. Sharp breaking curve ball. Just a little bit above the knees for a called strike, and it is now 2-0. Ripple steps out of the box for a moment and trying to try that bat of his.
Two men out. The bases are loaded. The Giants one run behind. Ripple is up, and the count is strike two. Here's the windup. Strike two. Here it is. It's a ball. A burning fast ball is high outside.
Yes, Charlie Ruffing attempted to pull the spring, as it were, on that one, but it was a little bit too high. And now the count on Ripple is strike two and ball one. Ripple is a left-hand batter. We find Selkirk playing pretty deep, with center and left closed in a little bit. DiMaggio is not playing over right center for his left-hand hitter. Strike two and ball one. That was a foul ball that accidentally hit the bat of Ripple. It gave the fans a little thrill for a moment. It looked like it might have been a pass ball. Ripple is up there. You know the bases are loaded. Charlie Ruffing again has his glove off. Now he has trying to get that pitching hand of his dried out. Boy, is that rain is coming down. It's 2-2. Here's the pitch. Ball three. That was a curve ball that was over, but just a little bit high. And now a roar goes up from the crowd. This is a tickling slap to the end. Yes, sir. Yes, it's a Dick Farwell spot if there ever was one. Strike three. Strike three with the bases loaded and the count 2-2. Ruffing came in with a hook ball at the low inside, and he swings and misses, and it's a strikeout with the bag loaded. At the end of three innings, the New York Yankees won. New York Giants nothing. Tied.
Johnny Ruffing got himself in a hole that time and then picked himself up. Carl Huffle first up. Got a wicked single right past Ruffing here in the center field. Then Red wore down a little bit and struck out Joe Moore. Dick Bartell and dodging a high inside pitch. Ball hit his bat and shot over Gary Kett for a single into right field, on which Hubble went all the way to third. Gary fouled out to Bill Dickey. Hot walk filling the bases. Ruffing pitching very carefully to him. Didn't give him a good ball. And then with a count 2-2 on Ripple and the bases loaded.
Came through there to fan the batter, giving him his fourth strikeout of the game so far. It's raining much harder, and it looks as though this game cannot go very much longer. All right, we start the fourth inning, Tom. Take it away.
Fourth inning, and Bill Dickey is coming up. Here's a bit of humor for you as we gaze out into center field. The folks and the bleachers out there have newspapers over their heads. As the rain continues down like it is for the moment, it'll be just too bad for their clothes and everything else. They all have newspapers now spread over their heads, trying to keep their shoulders and their necks from the rain. But they're not going to have much luck if it keeps coming down as fast as it is at the moment. The umpires have made no particular gestures yet to either delay the game or to call it. None whatever so far as we go to the first half of the fourth inning with the American League out in front by the score of 1-0, the result of a mighty home run by George Selkirk in the third inning. Now we have Bill Dickey, the Yank catcher, left-hand hitter up. Ball one. A sweeping curveball. Each time that Gehrig or Dickey has come to bat this afternoon, Carl Hubble seems to be throwing a sweeping curveball. Not particularly a sharp-breaking curve, and not particularly fast. It just seems like a sweeping curve. Here it is. Ball two. Same kind of a pitch as I just explained to you, a sweeping curve ball that hits the outside corner, and the count on Bill Dickey is ball two. He leads off for the Yanks in the fourth inning. Hubble again winds up. Strike. And that curve ball right over the heart of the plate. Bill Dickey elected to work the swing out with Hubble, and it is now ball two and strike one. There's the windup. It's a strike call. Carl Hubble seemed to burn that one in, and the count is ball two and strike two. That sort of surprised Bill Dickey a little bit because he wasn't looking for it, and he stepped away in spite of the fact it was over the heart of the plate. Ball two and strike two. Strike three.
Strike three, a nice curve ball that completely fooled Bill Dickey. Bill is walking away without an utterance to the umpire, perfectly satisfied, and it is one man out in the first half of the fourth and nobody out. We have Jake Paul, right-hand batter, the Yankee left fielder coming up. Carl Hubbell pitching and Gus Van Cuto on the receiving end. Wind up and we're off, first half of the fourth. All one. That was a curve ball over the plate, but just a little bit too high, and the count on Paul is one and nothing. Now even the ladies are sitting in their box seats, refusing to move. They're going to take this rain and light. He swings and misses. Ball one and strike one. I don't know, you can't blame them for that. They've been waiting for this old Yankee Giant World Series here in the Polo Grounds. It's been happening for a long time. Today they're getting it, and they're good sports. They're taking it. Ball one and strike one. One out, nobody on. Ball two. Jake Paul threw the first and third baseman in that time by sticking his bat out and just the butt, then pulled it away. It was the ball inside, and the count is two and one. Score, Yankees won, Giants nothing, first half, the fourth and half. Paul batting, ball two, strike one. It's a foul. That ball hits Gus Van Cuto on the leg, and it hurts a little bit. Yes, it does.
You know, in the National League, the umpire hands the ball to the catcher, while in the American League, the umpires toss the ball out to the pitcher. Now the count is two and two, Powell batting. Ball three. That curve ball of Hubbell failed to catch the outside corner to Powell, a right-hand batter. Now we have the count, ball three, strike two, one out, and nobody out.
There's a flying drive that Jackson reached for. Didn't get it. It's a base hit. Powell is rounding first. There's the play at second. It's going to be close. He slides. He's safe. A double. J.P. Powell wrapped that line drive over the head of third baseman Jackson. Jackson leaped in the air for it. Failed to negotiate the catch by inches. And the ball went on out and tearing off the wall 315 feet away, where it was picked up out there by Joe Moore. Moore kept loose with a flying throw, but Powell beat it only by an eyelash, and it's a two-base hit for Powell. Manager Bill Carey has walked over to the box. Gus Van Cuto, the catcher, has left his position behind the bat, and they are now out there on the mound talking to Carl Hubbell. You know, very frequently during a ball game, at no particular meeting or anything, but Bill Carey, being an encouraging manager and having that reputation, steps over in a spot like this and gives his players a few words of encouragement. So far, it seems to be the right strategy because they have won the National League pennant, of course. Runner on second, one man out. And we have Tony Lazzari coming up. A right-hand batter, Hubbell. Here it is. Strike. Foul ball. Tip ball that Gus Van Cuto hung on to. One man out. Jake Powell is on second. And the count is strike one. Ball one. That was a fast ball that knocked Tony Lazzari out of the batter's box. He stumbled over his foot, but he didn't go down. Ball one and strike one. I don't like to remind you of the rain so often, but it is a matter of importance now, and it is, the rain is still coming down very hard at the moment. Ball one and strike one. If it comes down any harder, they would have to call it, but nothing as yet. Another foul. Strike two and ball one. Catcher Mancuso ripped his mask and cap off. And that tip foul, now he has it adjusted, and he's back in there ready to go. First half of the fourth inning, you know. One man out, Jake Powell on second. Tony Lazzari is up, strike two and ball one. There's a pitch out, the throw at second. He's safe. There was a bit of inside baseball with that count, strike two and ball one. Mancuso definitely called for a pitch out. He whipped the ball down to second base to Burgess Whitehead, but Jake Powell, who had a pretty big lead, was able to get back. And the throw was just a little bit too high. Now we have to count ball two and strike two with Tony Lazzari at bat.
Here it is. Ball outside. Lazzari took almost a half swing at that ball as it broke away, but he was able to hold it to the satisfaction of the umpire in chief, and it's a ball and the count is 3-2.
We're going to tip our microphone over just a little bit and get it out of the range, so if you hear a click, that will be it. Ball four, Tony Lazzari walks. That counts 3-2. Apparently, that slippery ball got away from Hubble because it was at least 2 yards on the outside of the plate. Listen to this round of applause for Selkirk. It was Selkirk, you know, who exploded that mighty home run in the upper deck in right field to put the Yanks out in front in the third inning. As the Yankee batters come up to the plate now, they are carrying a huge towel. Pretty big towel to wipe that bat off before stepping into the batter's box. One man out. Lazzari is on first. Jake Powell on second. Carl Hubble in the box, the left-hand pitcher, and there's the stretch. First half of the fourth inning. One out. Strike. Boy, what a cut he took at that one. That brought a sigh and a roar out of the crowd. I'd say a sigh from the Giants fans and a roar from the Yankee fans. It's strike one. One man out, runners on first and second. The pitch, it's a steal, there he goes, there's the throw is good, and Powell is out at third base. Lazzari goes to second. The Yankees probably took into consideration that they had a slippery ball there, and with one man out, they attempted a double steal, and Gus Mancuso cut loose with that throw down to Jackson. The throw was high, but Jackson handled it very beautifully, and with the same motion, Chip put the ball on the runner, and Paul was declared out. Art Butcher, the coach at third base, thought perhaps that that was just close enough that the decision could have went to Powell, and he told the umpire so. But that's all over, and we have two men out. Lazzari is on second, Selkirk at bat, and it's ball one and strike one. There's the stretch. Ball two. Prior to that pitch, Dick Bartell, the Giants shortstop, running over and back of Tony Lazzari, trying to keep him as close to that bag as is possible. Burgess White at the second baseman is playing over about 10 or 15 feet from his second base position. Terry is playing over closer to the line. We find Mellott backed up against the right field fence. The pitch is a strike. He misses. Strike two and ball two. In the opinion of the Giants, Selkirk is a right field hitter. Very definitely so, because Ripple in center field is playing in deep right center. Mellott is playing over in front of the 339-foot sign and very close to the wall. With Terry and Whitehead both moves over to the right side of the diamond. The count is 2-2. There's the pitch. Ball three. That was almost a wild pitch. The ball hit the edge of home plate. Gus Mancuso, in trying to pick it up, batted it halfway out to the pitcher's box, walked out, picked it up, and has now walked all the way out to the pitcher's box. Day like this, you know, we almost feel inclined to say first down and 10 to go, or something like that. Two men out. Tony Lazzari is on second, the first half of the fourth inning. Score, Yankees 1, Giants nothing. The umpire has delayed the game for a moment, and the Giant mascot has walked out with a fresh bag of fudge. He dries his hand and then throws it back to the mascot. I wonder if they're going to go through with that procedure between each pitch. If we do, we'll be here to say Merry Christmas time. All right, it's 3-2. There's a bit of inside baseball that we overlooked. It's 3-2, and rather than to leave that rosin bag out there and get all wet, just walked out and gave him enough for this one pitch. The count 3-2, two men out, the runner on second. Here it is. Strike three!
Selkirk, as you all know by this time, responsible for the only run scored so far with his home run in the third inning, and leaving Lazzari on second to retire the Yankees in their turn in the fourth. Take it away, Tom.
Right at the moment, I see one of the groundskeepers taking care of home plate. The time we haven't let the boys around the country say good afternoon to us for quite a while. So if it's all right with you, we'll pause right now for station identification.
This is WMAQ, the Chicago Daily News Station.
With you again. We're going into the last half of the fourth inning. New York Yankees, you know, are ahead in this first game of the 1936 World Series by the score of 10-0. For the benefit of our friends who are just getting home from work or have just tuned in, the big dynamic flow of the game was that of George Selkirk, the Yankee right fielder, when he came to bat in the third inning, and he blasted a mighty home run up in the upper deck of the right field stands. Ready to go to bat now. And Gus Mancuso, first man up in the giant half of the fourth, hits the first ball, an infield fly, Ralph under it, and he has it. Red Ralph had a bit of difficulty in making that catch because the rain came down and, of course, battering in his eyes as he looked up following the play of the ball. One man out, Mancuso popped up to Ralph. Burgess Whitehead, right-hand batter, the giant second baseman, heads now on the plate. Ruffing pitching. A strike, a burning fast ball, right down the center in the bat, letter high. Last half of the fourth, one out, nobody out. A barrel back, that was another well-pitched ball. Battle roughing at a nice jump-breaking curve, trying to keep the ball high on Bridges' right head. Apparently, he's a low ball hitter. Strike three, he swings and misses. Two men out, nobody on with the giant half of the fourth. Still wet down on their home plate now, but Clive Thurman is launching out a new ball. So Dickie dropped it, they immediately threw it out of the game and gave another. There's a ball that doesn't take any abuse and doesn't see very much of the world too. Two out. Two out, nobody. Down and Jackson is up. Pounding ball down short, so Benny is up with it to throw. He's out. Jackson is out of the first ball quick. Short drop for Benny to Gary. No run, no hit, no errors. At the end of four innings, Yankees run, Giants nothing.
On long drive, the club. You're comfortable and safe in a 4-8. Exclusive Ford Center Poise principle traded you between the wheels, giving backseat riders a front seat ride. Luxurious interior appointments and rich attractive upholstery add to the pleasure of riding in a Ford V8. Ford brakes ensure safety.
The picture we see now, another one of the groundskeepers out there in the pitcher's box, and he has a pail filled with dry sand. He is tossing it around with his bare hands around there with the pitcher up his foot down and delivering the ball. Getting just a little bit slippy out there, and perhaps the Ruffing and Hubble are both complaining a little bit about it being slippy, so they're doing everything possible to keep this game going. Two men out, nobody on. First half of the fifth inning. Now we have Fred Rolfe coming up. Rolfe is a left-hand batter. Two men out, nobody on in the Yankee half of the fifth inning. Hubble winds up in the pitch. It's an infield fly between first and second. Burgess Whitehead is coming over. He is under it, and he has it. That is all for the New York Yankees in the first half of the fifth inning. As we go to the last half of the fifth, the score, of course, is the American League entry one and the National League entry nothing. There have been no changes in either lineup in this first game of the World Series. The boys started out with Gary get first, and this is the Yankee lineup. Gary gets first, Mazzari second, Rossetti at short, and Rolfe at third. And the strong point, Charlie Ruffing, their big, red-headed, smiling pitcher who has had a grand year in the American League, has been in the box, and Bill Dickey behind the bat. In the outfield, of course, they have Selkirk to hit that homer in right, DiMaggio in center, and Rolfe is in left field. Now for the Giants, of course, they have Moore in left field. Bartell playing short, Terry first, Malat right, Ripple in center, Mancuso catching, Whitehead at second, Jackson at third, and Carl Hubble in the box. They have made no changes, they're going along, and The big story of the game so far as we reach the first half is 1-0 in favor of the Yankees, and Carl Hubbell will be the first batter to win the last half of the fifth inning. This is Tom Manning speaking. I've had the pleasure of broadcasting the play-by-play the first half, and now the last half will come to you through the voice of Ty Pike.
Tom. All right, Tom, here we go. Move the mic a little bit. Up has one hit, the one time he's been at bat. So far, Hubbell has struck out four of the Yankees, while Red Ruffing has struck out five of the Giants. First pitch to Hubbell. Ball one, low and inside. Ruffing throws the rubber, starts his windup for the next pitch. It's coming in, and he fouled it back over Dickey's head. Strike one. The count is 1-1. Hubbell leading off in the Giants' half of the fifth. The score, 1-0 in favor of the Yankees. The Yankees have made five hits, and the Giants have made three. As far as bases on balls are concerned, Ruffing has passed two, and Hubbell has passed none. A foul ball going into the stand. Another strike, and the count is two strikes and one ball. Hubbell has walked one man. Ruffing gets a new ball. He roughed it up a little bit. Glove off his left hand, taking plenty of time out here. No wonder they can pitch the way they are with the adverse conditions. Here's the pitch, it's a curve ball, and he hits it on the ground to second base. There's the pickup, and he's out at first. Lazzeri to Gary. An easy chance for Tony Lazzeri. One man gone in the fifth. And Joe Moore, left fielder for the Giants. Slide out to left field the first time at bat, struck out the second time. One out and nobody on. Yankees leading 1-0. The last half of the fifth. Left-hand hitter, he steps in there. Ruffing raises his arm for the pitch, and it's a curve ball which he pops a foul. Dickey is going back for it. He's hung it. He has it. Two men out. Nobody on. And Dick Bartell, shortstop for the Giants, who also flied to left in the first inning and hit himself a single in the third inning. Right-hand batter comes up. Ruffing out there, pawing around at the pitcher's rubber. It's awfully tough out there, not only on gripping the ball, but also on their footwork, because their feet just balled up to this day, getting very muddy. And while he steps into the pitcher's slot, there's the windup, and it's a curve, low and outside, ball one. One ball is the count, two men off, nobody on. Redhead stamped around out there, kicks the mud out of his feet. He's on the rubber now in pitching position. There's the bend, there's the windup, and it's a sidearm curve. It fouls back on the roof here. Strike one. The count is 1-1. Two men out and nobody on. Ruffing gets a new ball and goes through the usual procedure of giving it just a bit of a rub, taking some of that shine off of it. The count is 1-1. Two men out and nobody on. 1-0 in favor of the Yankees. There's the windup. Here's the pitch. It's a drive out. Ruffing worked on a new ball. The score is tied at 1-1. There's the windup for the next pitch. It's coming in. And he hits it on the ground right at Tony Lazaria. Slow, and Tony comes in fast, throws him out at first to retire the side and end the fifth inning. One run. One hit. No errors.
Okay, anything was ever even. I guess this whole ball game is. If it's still purple, wrap that long home run in the third inning up to the upper deck of the right field stands. And now we find here in the last half of the fifth, Dick Bartel hits one equally as hard in the upper deck of left field. So it's all even as we go to the first half of the sixth.
If you want to enjoy yourself next Friday evening, listen to Fred Waring and his Pennsylvanians over the NBC network. It's the shortest half hour in radio. Well, as we go into that sixth inning, Joe DiMaggio is first up for the American Leaguers. Joe has had one hit in two times this bat. Rounded out the shortstop to end the first inning and singled to right field in the third inning. Score is square now at one run, each run being a home run. George Selkirk and Dick Bartel providing the home run. And the crowd, despite all the rain, seem to be very happy out here now. They're witnessing a grand ball game under very adverse conditions. There has not been an error made so far, and how the boys handle that slippery apple out there is more than I can tell. DiMaggio, a right-hand batter, steps in there. Carl Hubbell is doing the same as Charlie Ruffing was doing a bit ago, trying to get the mud out of his feet. He's on the rubber now, has the sign from Gus Mancuso. Starts his windup, and the first pitch is coming in there, and hit on the ground foul along third baseline, strike one. Being retrieved by shortstop Dick Bartel and thrown over to umpire Bill Summers, who is umpiring there at third base. And a new ball has been handed to Mancuso, who passes it along to Carl Hubbard. Four all square, one run. DiMaggio leading off in the sixth. John goes up for the pitch. Here it is. It's inside. Joe ducking away from that fastball. Ball one. High inside pitch. And the count 1-1. Huff hunches his shoulders a bit. Takes his time. The long breath. There's the windup. Here's the pitch. He swung and missed that in the third ball. Just under his swing. About a belt high pitch. Joe was looking for a high fast one. Following the one duck pitch, Hubble broke it down, and the count is 2 strikes and 1 ball. There's the motion for the next pitch. Another one out. That's the fifth strikeout registered by Hubble. Now all square with Ruffin. Lou Gehrig is up. No hit. In two times at bat. First time he grounded to Terry, who tossed to Hubble for the out. Second time he hit one right back. An easy ground to right back to Hubble. One away and one on. High score of one run. There's the motion. Here's the pitch. A called strike as Hubble broke the curve over belt high. One strike on Columbia lose. One man out of nobody on. Hubble pitching. The arm goes up for the motion. A curve low. Ball one. Count is 1-1. Umpire Cy Furman giving a new ball to Gus Mancuso. I believe the ball even gets wet coming in from the pitcher to the catcher. 1-1. Up back is motion. Here it is. A curve outside. It just missed that outside corner by inches. And Gus didn't believe it missed. He dumped it into his glove. He starts helping it back to Hubble. The count is 2 balls and 1 strike. Gehrig in there. Bending a little bit. Getting himself. There's the windup. Here's the pitch. And he hits it on the ground. Foul. Down the first baseline. Bill Carey made a nice kick up the top of him. Got a nice hand of applause from the crowd. The count now is 2 strikes and 2 balls. One man out, nobody on. He's
Gehrig, the batter, and the score tied at 1-1 as we're playing the first half of the sixth inning. Rutherford moved well a bit as his glove hanging on his arm. Now he puts the glove back on the right hand. Gehrig steps out of the batter's box, back in. All the batter's box lines have been obliterated long ago. They have to guess whether they're in or out. There's the motion. Here's the pitch. Gehrig fouled a pass, high one back, and the count is still 2-2. Came in there with a high passing, and Lou is just a bit under with his swing. Here's a nice gesture. Gus Mancuso giving Gehrig the little rosin bag, which he carries in his hip pocket. So Lou can get a little on his hands there. The bat won't slip out. There's a motion for the next pitch. And Gehrig. Number two in that inning and number six for the game. Cub had plenty of down on that one. Down and out to a left-hand hitter. Bill Dickey, another left-hand batter, is up. Grounded out second base, first time at bat, and banned the second time up.
One away and one off. High score of 1-1. There's the motion. Here's the pitch. A called strike has almost broke the curve over Bell Five. One strike on Columbia Lou. One man out and nobody on. Double pitching. The arm goes up for the motion. A curve low, ball one. Count is 1-1. Umpire Cy Furman giving a new ball to Gus Mancuso. I believe the ball even gets wet coming in from the pitcher to the catcher. 1-1. Up catches motion. Here it is. A curve outside. It just missed that outside corner by inches. And Gus didn't believe it missed. He dumped it into the glove. That's passing it back to Hubble. The count is 2 balls and 1 strike. Gehrig in there. Bending a little bit. Setting himself. There's the windup. Here's the pitch. And he hits it on the ground. Ball down the first baseline. Bill Carey made a nice pickup of batting. Got a nice hand of applause from the crowd. The count now is 2 strikes and 2 balls. 1 man out, nobody on. Lou Gehrig, the batter, and his score tied at 1-1 as he's playing the first half of the sixth inning. Couple left to the blue ball a bit as his glove hanging on his arm. Now he puts the glove back on the right hand. Gehrig steps out of the batter's box, back in. All the batter's box lines have been obliterated long ago. They're trying to guess whether they're in or out. There's the motion. Here's the pitch. Gehrig fouled a pass, high one back. And the count is still 2-2. Came in there with a high passing. And Lou is just a bit under with his swing. Here's a nice gesture. Gus Mancuso giving Gehrig the little rosin bag, which he carries in his hip pocket. So Lou can get a little on his hands there as the bat won't slip out. There's the motion for the next pitch. And Gehrig. Number two in that inning and number six for the game. Cub had plenty of down on that one. Down and out to a left-hand hitter. Bill Dickey, another left-hand batter, is up. Grounded out second base, first down at bat, and spanned the second time up. Double is ready. There's a slow windup, and the first pitch to Bill is a curve over that outside corner between the knees and the belt for a called strike. Double is certainly bending that sponge out there now. There's a motion for the next one. A fast one. High over the outside corner for the second called strike. Dickey looking for a curve that time, and Carl Crossing has got the fastball knee high. And the count is 2-0. 2 men out, nobody on. The score tied at 1-1. Sixth inning is the day of the big rain. The arm goes up in the motion. Here's the pitch. Low outside. Great ball there. 2-0 the count. He thought maybe Dickey might go for a batting. And the count, 2 strikes and 1 ball. Hubble has the sign. Mancuso comes up out of the crouch. Here's the pitch. Dickey hit one down first baseline right over the bag. Terry has it, waving everybody away, and Bill is out. Terry, unassisted. No run, no hit, no error. Take it away.
That round of applause, of course, is for none other than the pride and joy of Manhattan, Carl Hubble. Winning of that inning facing DiMaggio, Jerry, and Dickey. That's a large afternoon's assignment for most anybody. You know, that's the dynamite of the American Leaguers. DiMaggio has a batting average of .324. Lou Gehrig, .354, leading the league in home runs. And Bill Dickey with .362. He stood out there in that range with that slippery ball and just bent those old curves over until he got DiMaggio. And then Gehrig couldn't make up his mind whether or not to strike at that third one. But he went all the way through, was called out. And then Bill Dickey, after getting two called strikes, hit to Bill Curry for the out on assist. Well, the bleachers out in center field, practically deserted at the moment. As many as can have gotten over into the vacant seats of the stands, standing under cover out there, and up along the board edge, up on top, they're still standing there getting whatever little shelter they can get. The field is becoming very, very wet, dangerously wet, I'd say, as we go to the last half of the sixth inning and the score 1-1. No, little to choose between the teams. Hubble and Ruffing both pitching grand ball, and the runs are the result of homers by Selkirk and Bartell. Both about equal in distance, I think we've agreed. Going in now with Mellock, left-hander, coming to bat.
Mellock walked both times at bat so far. And he's in there, left-hand hitter. Ruffing on the rubber, ready to go. There's the windup, and the first pitch to watch this time is high and outside. Ball one. Always comes up with that back foot as the pitch starts. Not a very big fella. He's got a lot of power behind that swing. Ruffing tosses the ball around in his glove out there. Ready to pitch. Here's the motion. And outside fastball. Ball two.
Nothing. It must be tough for you to take over these points. You've got a little coop over there. You don't get hit with a swing, do you?
Oh, yeah. Oh, they got rain, too.
Yeah?
Here we're out.
Not like this, though.
Not never rain, too. They call a game in rain like this. You can't do that World Series. Have to go a little longer. The crowd. Count is 2-0 on Mel. Leading off in this Giants half of the sixth. Score is tied at one run. A foul strike hitting it in the dirt right at his feet. Ruffing coming through with a belt-high pitch. Broke in close to his thumbs. And the count is 2 balls and 1 strike. Ruffing is doing some more excavating out there, trying to find the pitcher's slab. Well, when that rubber gets wet, it's not a very good thing to take off from when you're trying to get them in here over the plate. Foul, strike two. A low fastball, knee high. And the count is 2-2. Charlie certainly is kicking that pitcher's slab around out there. Feet are probably balled up just like a horse when he's on soft snow. The milk horse that comes around early in the morning in February. Ruffing is ready. There's the motion. And here's the pitch. A slow curve, and he waited for it to hit it out in the left field. Starting with the ball, bouncing against the wall. It's at least a two base hit for up. He goes into second, standing up. Down the left field line. Dickey Powell played the ball as hard as possible, but he had plenty of time to go into second base standing up. Did not pass through the swing. Jim Ripple, no hits in 2 times as bad as that. Incidentally, that hit got hot, made the wind ball square. Each team now has 5 hits, and each team has 1 run. Pretty even ball game. First pitch is a bunt, right in front of the plate to Ruffing. Ruffing tosses by it, Lazeri, covering first.
kept one foot on the bag while reaching for this to retire the runner. Sacrifice, advancing hot to third. The play, roughing to Lazzari, who covered first. Best man Chusso up. Off his move over to third on the sacrifice. In position to score on a hit. A long fly ball, an error. Most anything. And the score is tied at one run. It looks like the Giants' golden opportunity. The boys are kicking mud off their feet. Plenty of wet spots out there now, puddles on the, that you can see on the skin part of the field. Undoubtedly, the grass is very slippery. Yankee infield pinched in for a play at the plate on a ground ball. Ruffing is not ready yet. He's still working with that, kicking a dirt around the pitcher's rubber. Blows on that pitching hand to get a better grip on the ball. Now he's ready to go. There's the motion. And here's the pitch. It's a foul strike back. One strike on Mancuso. Banned the first time at bat. Popped her off the second time up. Six hits apiece, one run apiece. Five hits apiece and one run apiece. Charlie is ready. There's the motion. And here's the next pitch to Gus. It's low and outside. Dickey making a fine recovery of a badly pitched ball down in the mud. He hands it to umpire Cy Fierman and gets a new white in exchange for this bit of damaged horse hat. Still is walking out halfway to the box. Pass it to Ruffing. All the boys kicking mud out of their shoes. And the count is 1-1 on Mancuso. One and one. Ruffing starts his windup. Here's the pitch coming in. A fast ball and he hits it. Steps inside the foul line out in left field corner for a single. Scoring hot for the second run for the Giants. And putting them in the lead. The American or the National League is leading now. 2-1 with one man out, and Cuso on first, and Burgess Whitehead. Second baseman for the Giants is up. And the boys are working very slowly out there. One man away, and Cuso on first. He played that one safely. With a dry field, he might have been able to make second. Coacher held him up there at first base, not taking any chances. Score 2-1 in favor of the National League. Sixth inning of a very foggy afternoon at the Polo Ground. Burgess Whitehead, right-hand hitter. And the first pitch is a foul strike. Sticks it right into Bill Dickey's mitt. One strike on Whitehead. One man out. Mancuso on first. Just takes a bit of a lead, not very much. And the next pitch is a pop fly to the center of the diamond. Red Roth coming in almost to the plate to make that catch for the second out. Roth, Yankee third baseman, came in almost to home plate to make the catch of that pop fly by Burgess Whitehead. Travis Jackson, third baseman for the Giants, fanned the first time, grounded out short to first. Second time at bat is up. Just Mancuso on first and two men out. The Giants leading 2-1 in the sixth inning. There's a stretch. Here's the pitch. A high fly out into short left center field. Joe DiMaggio setting himself under it for the catch. He has it. And that ends the sixth inning. One run. Two hits. No error. One man left. Hunt opened with a double. Sacrifice to third by Ripple. Came home on Mancuso's single to left. Whitehead pops the roll. And Jackson flies to DiMaggio's short left center.
F4BH is powerful yet economical. Tests show better than 20 miles to the gallon at speeds up to 40 miles per hour. All right, Tom.
Well, it's still a ball game. It's 2-1 now in favor of the National League. The Giants, of course, going to run across that time when Melvin Ott, the right fielder, crossed the Yanks up and poked a double down the left field corner. Then, of course, he came home on the single that followed, putting the National League in front at the end of six innings, 2-1. Again, the umpires are coming over near the pitcher's box, and once more, the groundkeeper is rushed out with a pail full of dry dirt. Very hard for Hubble or Ruffing to get a foothold out there, particularly so after they come down on their foot and deliver the ball. Seems to be sliding away on them. They're going to be detained for a few moments from time to time until they dry up that time. Been on the air. The game has started about two hours ago. We've only completed six innings. That's very slow, but one of the reasons that we observed for that slowness is that these two teams are very deliberate in figuring everything out. It's going to be a rather lengthy game. Well, we passed two-thirds of the way. We're going into the first half of the seventh. The American League is coming to bat, and we'll have Jakey Powell, the left fielder, right-hand batter, first up. It's Carl Hubble and Mancuso, still the strong point for the Giants. Carl Hubble is having a lot of difficulty out there in getting his foothold. He's still kicking the mud around and trying to smooth it. But in a moment or so, we'll be ready with the first pitch in the seventh.
Powell has had a single and a double in the two times he's been at bat so far. Hubble raises his arm for the first pitch to Jakey, and he hits that one on the line over shortstop head, taken on the first hop out in left field by Joe Moore, a single. This makes Jake a perfect day at bat. Two singles and a double. Tony Lazzari is up, the tying runners on first base. Lazzari fanned the first time at bat and walked the second time up. 2-1 in favor of the Giants. This is the seventh inning just opening up. I don't know but what they'll rechristen this field after today and call it the water polo ground instead of just the plain polo ground. Getting very much inundated. Hubble pitching from the shoulder without a windup with a runner on base, and the first one comes in there knee high for a called strike on Lazzari, right hand hitter. One strike on push him up Tony. Jakey Powell taking practically no lead off first. The heavy going, now he's edging off just a bit, and a toss to first drives him back. Wasn't even close. One strike on Lazzari. Hubble is on the rubber, ready to pitch now. Here it comes, and it's outside. Ball one. Waist high pitch outside. Count is even at 1-1. Powell on first with a tying run. The Giants are leading 2-1, and this is the seventh inning. Carl has the sign. Mancuso comes up out of the crowd. Here's the pitch. Lazzari hitting a foul on the ground off third baseway for the second strike. Powell was well on his way and around second base. Coming back now, the count is two strikes and one ball. 2-1. Lazzari drying his hands on his sock. Steps back in the batter's box now. Kicks a little mud off his cleat. Or rather, a lot of mud off his cleat. Count is two strikes and one ball. Nobody out. There's the stretch for the next pitch. Coming in. Lazzari took that one, a high one. Ball two. Just a little bit high, and the count is 2-2. Once again, Hub is ready. There's the stretch. Powell edging a bit off first. Here comes a pitch to Lazzari, and he swings and misses for the third strike. A ball that was outside. And that's number seven for Hubble. One man gone. Selkirk is up. George hit his home run the first time at bat to put the Yankees in the lead, and then struck out the last time up, leaving Lazzari on second to end the fourth inning. Powell on first, one out. And Hubble is passing to first. Powell back safely. Powell gets set again in there. Not in pitching position. Now he is. There's the stretch. Coming in. Swinging strike, a curve that was breaking away from him. He just managed to stick it to the end of his bat. And the count is one strike on Twinkle Toes George Selkirk. Right fielder for the Yankees. Hubble clutching the ball. Glancing over here, getting the sign. Now he looks over toward first base. Powell takes a little bit of a lead. Here's the pitch. He hits it on the ground to Terry. Terry is pausing to shortstop, forcing Powell at second. Selkirk on first with two down. And Powell is forced at second. Terry to Bartell. Charlie Ruffing is up. Rounded out to the pitcher the first time at bat. Struck out the second time up. Charlie was a good hitting pitcher. He's often used in the role of a pinch hitter, just like brother Wesley Farrell of the Boston Red Sox. The first pitch to Ruffing is low. He's a right-hand batter. Ball one. Two men out. Selkirk on first. The score 2-1 in favor of the Giants in the seventh inning of the first game. Hubble takes his time. Taking a stretch now. He's ready. Here's the pitch to Ruffing, and he hits a foul back here right. One. And the count is 1-1. Back here in the stand. Two men out. Two men out and one man off. Hubble hunches his shoulders a bit. Now he's ready. There's the stretch. Toss to first instead. Selkirk back without much effort. Ray Hurd, Earl Combs out there keeping him on, coaching. Here's the pitch to Ruffing, and he struck out, swinging. Going for a slow, low breaking curve. No run. One hit. No error. Powell led off with a single. Lazzeri bang. Selkirk forced Powell at second. Terry to Bartell. And Ruffing went down swinging. Take it, Tom.
Well, that's the resume given you by Ty. Now we're going into the last half of the seventh. New York Giants and are out in front by the score of 2-1. A lot of you are getting home from work, so we might tell you that the Yanks took the lead in the third inning. George Selkirk, right fielder and left-hand batter, blasted a mighty home run high up in the upper deck of the right field stand. Home run perhaps from any ballpark in either league. And Dick Bartell even matters up by blasting equally as long a home run in the opposite direction in the upper deck in left field. That home run that Selkirk hit was over 339 feet. It's marked on the ground. I believe it's almost 50 feet to the railing upstairs, and that's where he poked that home. Bartell's is over the 315-foot sign, and it's about 50 feet up to the railing of the upper deck there. So you can well imagine what a mighty poke that was.
WMAQ, Chicago.
And drives that are close to the bag and so forth. So again, we shall hear from the boys over the network of NBC, and we pause for station identification.
WMAQ, Chicago.
As we sit here in the National Broadcasting Company box at the Polo Grounds in New York City for this first game of the World Series between the Giants of the National League and the Yankees of the American League, we're thinking for a moment of the folks perhaps around the country who are enjoying a bright sunshine day. Very bad day here in New York yesterday. late last night. It was caught by many of the folks in charge, and today's game will have to be called up. However, we got up this morning, and it was a bright day. Very acceptable to baseball. Came here to the Polo Grounds, and shortly after the start of the ball game, it became very cloudy and started to drizzle. That drizzle increased, and we've been sitting in a pretty steady downpour of rain since that home run in the third inning. Perhaps that home run had something to do with the disturbing element, but anyhow, it has really been raining. Players are drenched, the field is drenched, and the spots out there now are becoming very wet. That round of applause you heard a moment ago for the groundkeepers who have just prepared the diamond and spot, and partly for Carl Hubbell, who will be the leadoff man for the Giants in the last half of the seventh.
He's up there now. He's had one hit and two times at bat. Ruffick starts lined up, and the first pitch to Hubbell is hit. A pop fly, Lou Gehrig in foul territory, coming over here for the catch. About 50 feet away from first base toward the field box. One man out. And next is Joe Moore with no hits in the two times he's been up there. Three times, rather. The rain is even obliterating the marks on the scorecard. Moore, another left-hand hitter. And Ruffing is ready. Here's the pitch. He hits one out to dead center field. DiMaggio circling under it, waiting for it, and has it. He hardly had to move for that one. Dead center field fly ball. Two outs. None on. And Dick Bartel, whose home run put the Giants on equal terms with the Yankees. Then a little later, Mellott's double. Gus Mancuso's single. Shot them into the lead. Bartel has had a single and a home run and three times at bat. Little fella, right-hand hitter. Crappy lad. There's the motion on the first pitch to Dick. Is a high fly, foul. Back at third base. It's being chased by Red Ross, but it's in the stands. Another souvenir bounding around there. We were a little alarmed earlier in the game when Ross crashed into a railing of a field box down here. Because, you know, Red has been out of the game part of the time with a cracked rib. Didn't know whether that would do him any harm or not. Evidently it didn't. One strike on Bartel. Two men out. Nobody on the seventh. Score 2-1 in favor of the Giants. National League representative. And here's the next pitch to Dick. It's a high fly right out in front of the plate. Now it's blowing foul, and Dickie comes back after circling a bit. Almost fell before making the catch. And the side is retired. Three up and three away. No run, no hit, no error. Hubbell foul to Gehrig. Moore fly to DiMaggio. And Bartel foul to Dickie. While waiting for the Yankees to come to bat, we would like to call to your attention the Ford and Lincoln Zephyr dealers' nationwide clearance sale of used cars. More than 150,000 outstanding bargains in dependable transportation are offered. Your nearby Ford dealer has his share. See his selection of used cars and late models of all the popular makes. All right, Tom.
Well, the old ball game was moving along. The American League entry is going to have to step on it very shortly. Now completed the seventh inning. We have two more whacks at the southpaw slant of Mr. Hubbell. Find the top of the batting order coming up again. Just a moment ago, the officials here at the Polo Grounds in New York have estimated the crowd for the first day at 48,000 people. And the seating capacity here in the Polo Grounds of just a little bit over 51,000. So the estimated attendance for the first game, in spite of the fact that it has been a gloomy, rainy day, threatening weather ever since yesterday morning, they have 48,000 people here. Tomorrow's game will also be played at the Polo Grounds, and with a day like this, I suggest the boys get themselves some oars, because it is still raining, still awfully wet out there. First half of the evening, Hubbell ready, Rossetti in the box, and here we go.
Frank has had no hits in three times at bat. Hubbell starts his windup, and the first pitch to Rossetti is a ground ball foul. Down third baseway, strike one. Jackson went over there, of course, but the ball was outside, probably 10 feet. One strike on Crosetti. leading off in the eighth inning. Hubble working slowly, hitching up his trousers, drying off the ball. Now he's ready to go. There's the motion. It comes in there. It's another one down third baseline, and that was fair by inches, going on out into the corner for two bases if he can make it. He overslid the bag. He's safe. This was a great play down there at second base. Left fielder shoved that ball in there very fast. Joe Moore to Burgess Whitehead, the second base. Frassetti beat the throw, but overslid the bag. Then Whitehead missed the tag as Frassetti was sliding back. And he's waved safely by umpire Major Kurt. Frassetti on second. As a result of that double, just inside the third baseline. Babbitt Jackson dives for the ball. Couldn't possibly get it. And squirted on out in the corner in foul territory. Now they've got a couple of towels out there, drying off both the lads that were on the ground, Bartell and Frassetti. And now the Yankees have another chance to tie the score. The runner on second and nobody out.
It's like a football game. Look at the towels out there.
Certainly does. Well, it's certainly more football weather than baseball weather.
I think that's one of the funniest plays we ever saw tonight. Both those boys are off the
swimming.
Bag. Neither one of them
could
get enough
football back
to make the player get back to the bag right. Or anything else.
Absolutely. They're both doing that Australian crawl. Well, the next man up is Red Rolfe. One hit and three times at bat, a left-hand hitter. And the tying run is on second base. Betty standing down there in one of the puddles. Bartell right behind him, running over to second. Foul, attempting to bunt. The idea is to move him around if possible. But Rolfe's best effort that time was a foul off to the left of the plate. Strike one. The remarkable thing of this game, Tom, is no errors.
Look at the white uniforms in it.
A lot of mutters out there. Bartell is not giving Frassetti any chance for a lead there with this expected sacrifice play coming up. Here's the pitch, and it's outside. Ball one, one and one. They're keeping Jackson anchored at third, with Terry and Hubble looking after the bunt. And Whitehead, or Bartell rather, keeps Frassetti from taking any lead off second. Standing right on the bag now. Frassetti has about a 10-foot lead. Hubble takes his stretch. Here's the pitch to Rolfe. He bunts one in front of the plate. And Hubble fails to pick the ball up. Just a minute till we get the official ruling on that. Hubble failed to field this bounding ball off the wet grass. A sacrifice and an error. No time at bat for Rolfe. An error charge to Hubble. First error of the ball game, and that moves Frassetti over to third.
I should have delayed for a moment while he was explaining that. I had a chance to get my ear close enough to the official score. They had a discussion on that. Hubble came tearing in. His feet gave way, and there was quite some deciding up there among the officials as to whether to score that as a hit or an error.
They let it go as a sacrifice and error.
That's right.
Okay. DiMaggio up. One hit in three times at bat. Tying run is on third. Nobody out. Another possible run on first. Score 2-1 in favor of the Giants. First half of the eighth inning. Joe got his hit, a single to right field in the third inning. Grants the shortstop and struck out on other trips to the plate. Stepped out of the batter's box just now as Hubble was about ready to pitch. Carl has already fanned eight of the Yankees. Here's the first one coming in, and it's a low line drive for a double play, almost a triple play. A low line drive. The first is Whitehead taking it off his shoe top and tossing to Terry to double Walt off first. Two men out. Frassetti still on third. That was a rescuing play that pulled Hubble out of a bad spot.
And the Giants are huddling around the pitcher's box now with Gehrig coming up. He may be ordered to pass him, although Gehrig has not gotten the ball out of the infield. Grounding first to Terry, then to Hubble, and the last time up, he struck out. DiMaggio lined to Burgess, a low line drive off to Burgess' left. He picked it off his shoe top, then threw to Terry to double Rolf off first. And the crowd is still in an uproar over that play. Rossetti is being fouled off a bit, where he's been down on the ground. Gray pants are not quite so spotless as they were when the team took the field this afternoon. Now here's the picture, two men out, the tying run on third, and Lou Gehrig is the batter. All right, here's the windup. First pitch to Lou, hit him right in the rib. Gehrig hit with a pitch ball. He isn't hurt. Taking the mud off his clothes and going slowly down to first base. Runners on third and first. Two men out and Dickey with no hit in three times as bad as up. Bill hasn't gotten the ball out of the infield either. Grounding out to second base, striking out, and grounding to Terry. Men out, Rossetti on third. Gehrig on first. That certainly was a rescuing play on the part of second baseman Burgess Whitehead. Dickey, a left-hand batter in there, waving a Hubble. Up takes his stretch. And here's the pitch. It's an inside pitch, letter high, ball one. Dickey backing away from it. 4-2-1 in favor of the Giants. Eighth inning, runners on third and first and two out. Hubble takes his stretch for the next pitch to Dickey. And Bill hits an easy bounder to Terry at first. Terry making the put out and ending a very exciting inning. And listen to that crowd roar. No run, one hit, and the first error of the ball game.
That was easily the outstanding inning of the first game of the World Series. And a lot of things happened, and here they are. Rossetti first up, and he hit one just over that bag for a double. He then slid into second base, overslid the bag. Burgess Whitehead, who handled the ball after it was retrieved by Moore, tried to make that play at second, but he was out there in the mud, and he was sliding around, just couldn't get on his feet or on his knees either, and neither could Rossetti. But finally, Rossetti got back, and I thought that was a beautiful decision by Major Kurth, who just kept his nose right over that play until it's complete. Then Rolf laid down a bunt, Hubble, in a hurry to knock that Rossetti off at third base, overran the ball. The official scorers then decided it to be scored as a sacrifice and an error. DiMaggio then came to bat, and he smacked one of the hardest hit balls of the afternoon, a low line drive, on its way to right field. Whitehead came over, picked the ball off his shoe top, then threw it to Bill Terry. And here's where a great bit of brain work came in. Bill Terry had a chance to enter the Hall of Fame with his Giants, as it were, by making a triple play. He saw that Rossetti was off that bag, but that ball was awful slippery, particularly after it had been tossed around by Whitehead and himself. Instead of throwing that ball over to third base and possibly into the stands, very coolly, he stood there and hung onto the ball and was satisfied with a double play. Then, of course, Gehrig was hit by a pitch ball, and the mighty Yankee catcher, Bill Dickey, left-hand batter, came up and found it out weakly to Terry unassisted. Well, I thought that was an outstanding bit of framework on the part of manager Bill. Instead of trying to complete the double, triple play, he was satisfied with a double and that one-run lead that they have as they go into the last half of the eighth, and Terry at bat.
Bill is up there, and here comes Ruffing's first pitch. It's a called strike, low-breaking curve about knee-high. One strike on Terry, who has made one hit in the three times he's been at bat. 1-3. There's the windup for the next pitch, and here it is. It's a drive out into right center field. Good for a base. DiMaggio heaving it into second. Lazzari has it now, and Terry is on first as the result of his second hit in this game. Nobody out. Giants leading 2-1.
And Mel Ott with a perfect game, two walks and a double, is the next batter. Left-hand hitter. And we'll see whether the Giants play for another run or try for maybe a cluster of them. Chances are that Ott will sacrifice here. Red Rolf is expecting it. He's in on the wet grass, playing in from third base. Repping takes his stance on the rubber. There's the stretch. Then it's a pitch outside and low, ball one. Carry on first and nobody out in this eighth inning. Giants out in front, 2-1. Ruffing throws the rubber, he's ready. There's the stretch, pitching without a windup. He's swinging and fouling it back. Strike one, the count is 1-1. That may be just a bit of camouflage. He may shorten up and bunt on this next one. Never can tell what these boys are going to do to cross up the opposition. 1-1 is the count. Ruffing coddles the ball a bit. He's ready now. There's the stretch, and here's the pitch. It's a bunch along first baseline. He dragged it down there. He may get a hit. He did. It dragged that along first baseline for a single. Jerry came in for it, but for the time Lou could get the ball, there was no chance for the play at first, and that gives Ott a perfect day. Two hits in two official trips to the plate. Walked the first two times, doubled the third time, and dragged the bunt along first baseline for a single to advance Terry. The Giants have runners on second and first. Nobody out, and Jim Ripple is up. Jim has no hits in two official trips up. Laid down a sacrifice the last time up to move Hop over to third, where he scored on Mancuso's single. That hit's putting the Giants in the lead, 2-1. Now both Gehrig and Rolf are in on the grass, expecting a bunt from Ripple, right-hand batter, or left-hand batter, rather. Ruffing takes his stretch, and along third baseline, fair. Strike on Terry, who has made one hit in the three times he's been at bat. 1-3. There's a windup for the next pitch, and here it is. It's a drive out into right center field. Good for a base. DiMaggio heaving it in the second. Lazzari has it now, and Terry is on first as the result of his second hit in this game. Nobody out. Giants leading 2-1. And Mel Ott with a perfect day, two walks and a double, is the next batter. Left-hand hitter. And we'll see whether the Giants play for another run or try for maybe a cluster of it. Chances are that Ott will sacrifice here. Red Rolf is expecting it. He's in on the wet grass, playing in from third base. Ruffing takes his stance on the rubber. There's the stretch. And it's a pitch outside and low, ball one. Carry on first and nobody out in this eighth inning. Giants out in front, 2-1. Ruffing throws the rubber, he's ready. There's the stretch, pitching without a windup. He's swinging and fouling it back. Strike one, the count is 1-1. That may be just a bit of camouflage. He may shorten up and bunt on this next one. Never can tell what these boys are going to do to cross up the opposition. 1-1 is the count. Ruffing bottles the ball a bit. Ready now. There's the stretch, and here's the pitch. It's a bunt along first baseline. He dragged it down there. He may get a hit. He did. A drag bunt along first baseline for a single. Gehrig came in for it, but for the time Lou could get the ball, there was no chance for the play at first, and that gives Ott a perfect day. Two hits in two official trips to the plate. Walked the first two times, doubled the third time, and dragged the bunt along first baseline to the single to advance Terry. The Giants have runners on second and first. Nobody out, and Jim Ripple is up. Jim has no hits in two official trips up. laid down and sacrificed the last time up to move Hop over to third, where he scored on Mancuso's single. That hit putting the Giants in the lead 2-1. Now both Gehrig and Wall put in on the grass, expecting a bunt from Ripple, a right-hand batter, or left-hand batter, rather. Ruffing takes his stretch, and then that first pitch is bunted along third base line. Fair. He got it first on a sacrifice of play being Walsh and Gehrig handling that wet ball nicely. Advancing both runners, and the Giants have Perry on third, and Hot on second with one out. Ripple has come through nicely. Both times have been up there ordered to sacrifice. Play with Walsh to Gehrig, third to first. Mancuso, one hit, and a very timely one at that. In three times at bat, right-hand batter is the next one. And again, the Yankee infield forced to play in for a play at the plate. How the boys handle this ball off that wet turf, beyond me. Ruffing starts his windup, it's a pitch out, ball one. About this next one. And then we'll tell you it's an intentional pass. Ball two. Mancuso is being given an intentional pass. Bring up Whitehead to set the stage for double play. Ball three. Three balls. And the arm goes up for the next one. Ball four. Intentional pass to Mancuso, setting the stage for what the Yankees hope will be a double play ball, with Burgess Whitehead furnishing the ground ball hit, and we'll see whether Burgess crosses the dope. He's had no hits in three times at bat. Perry on third, Ott on second, Mancuso on first, one man out, 2-1. In favor of the Giants. Eighth inning. First game of the 1936 World Series. Here's the first pitch to Whitehead. A curve outside. Ball one. Ruffing kicks some more of that blue dirt out of his shoes out there. They've built up that pitcher's peak several times this afternoon. Fresh earth. There's the windup for the next one. Inside and high, ball two. And the count is 2-0. One man out of the bases loaded. Two and nothing. Whitehead taps the plate with his bat. Count is 2-1. Blows on that meat hand, rubs the ball a bit. Ready to go now. There's the windup. Here's the pitch. It's a pop ball back here. Strike two. And the count is 2-2. On the rubber now. There's the windup. 2-2 is the count. Here's the pitch. It's low and outside. Oh, three. Base on balls, forced in a run. A hit will score one or more. And the count is 3-2. What will it be? Ruffing is on the rubber. There's the windup. Here it comes. It's ball four, low. Forcing in. Manager Bill Perry with the third run for the Giants, and keeping the bases still packed with one man out. Score is now 3-1 in favor of the Giants. The National Leaguers and Travis Jackson, no hits in three times at bat, is the next hitter. Right-hand batter. And now we find Ott on third, Mancuso on second, and Whitehead on first. One man out. Jackson, a right-hand batter, is up. Ruffing starts winding. Here's the pitch. Jackson swinging and missing. Was in close to the handle. To a right-hand batter, strike one. Travis is walking around in the mud down there and trying to kick it off his feet. Ruffing starts his winding, and here's the next pitch. A curve low, and he swung at that one for the second strike. He's protesting that he didn't go through with his swing, but umpire Fearman shake it ahead. It's strike two, 2-0. One man out, three men on, and the pitch is outside, ball one. Knee-high pitch outside, and the count, two strikes and one ball. One man out, and the base is packed. Ruffing rubs that new ball a bit. Hiding it behind him, now he's on the rubber, working with a full motion, of course, the base is loaded. Low ball two, and the count is 2-2. Only one error made in this game, played under very terrible conditions. Not a very excusable one. I've seen those made even on dry field. Kind of double made. Ruffing takes his time. There's the motion. Here's the pitch. It's a foul ball. Just a souvenir. Count was already 2-2. Foul ball out of the stand. First base wait. 2-2 with one out and three off. And the score 3-1 in favor of the New York Giants. National League entry in this World Series. Ruffing doesn't like the ball he has. He's tossing it away, getting a new one.
By a point of emphasis, Johnny focused on their warming up, and on the other side, that left-hander happens to be Lefty Gomez. That means one of two things. Boca may relieve, and Gomez may be the tip-off on tomorrow's starter. What do you think?
I think Lefty will start tomorrow. He's getting nice and wet, so he'll be in shape if it keeps on raining. Still waiting here for Ruffing to get going again with a count 2-2. To Jackson with the bases packed and one out. There's the windup, and here's the pitch. He hits a high fly ball out of the center field. DiMaggio surfing under it. It's far enough to score the runner from third. Joe has it. Here comes his throw. Let's hop. Crosses the plate. Standing up for the fourth. Giant run. Mancuso tying up at second, and of course Whitehead then remaining on first. Travis Jackson drove in that fourth run. And Carl Hubbell was at one hit, three times at bat, pitched himself out of some tough spots, gets a great hand as he comes up. Two men gone now. Jackson, high and long fly to DiMaggio, which scored Ott for the second run of this inning, and the fourth for the Giants of the game. And here's the pitch. Hubble broke his bat, grounding a slow one for Lazzari. And Lazzari allowed the ball to hop off his shoulder when it took a high bound. This scored Mancuso. Lazzari's throw getting away from Dickey. Still is chasing it, throwing to Ruffing. Whitehead in, and Hubbell went all the way to third. Pretty much of a riot here. Ball took a ball pop over Lazzari's shoulder. Looking for the official scorer to see whether he gives it a hit or an error. He hasn't made up his mind back here yet. There's a committee of three to go through this. Tom, you watch while I go over that play again, see what they give it. Hubbell broke his bat, hitting the slow bounder toward second base. As Lazzari rushed in to make the play, ball took a ball pop over his shoulder out in the short right field. This permitted Mancuso to score. Then when Whitehead also followed Mancuso across the plate. And before Dickey could get the ball back into the playing field, Hubble had gone all the way to third, where they put a blanket on Carl. And he's standing over there. We'll get this dope for you from the official scorer. Tom is watching him up here behind. I'm trying to watch the field of play.
All right, by there's the official announcement. Carl Hubble came to bat with runners on first and second, gets a hit on the ball and found it past Gazzelli.
Bad
ball. Gazzelli steals that ball and gets an error on his fast throw to the plate.
Right.
Two men out. Hubble on third. Joe Moore is up.
One strike. Ball. Score is 6-1 now in favor of the Giants. A smash through the box. Gazzelli coming over near second made a nice pickup and threw him out at first. Ending that eighth inning, and it was a glorious inning for the Yankees, for the Giants, rather. Four runs, three hits, and two errors. It only takes one to hit it, with a familiar cry from the fans. One ride in a Ford V8 will make a hit with you. The luxurious interior will impress you, and you'll thrill with remarkable surge of power when you step on the accelerator of the finest sports car ever built. Tom, go ahead and give them what happened.
Well, Sonny happened. Not to give it to you fast. Terry first up, singles to right center. That ball was well hit on a dry day. Perhaps it would have been good for extra base. Fell on. Cinnamon kept his sacrifice. Pulled a punt down the first baseline and beat it up. Jim Ripple. Right down and sacrifice, out calls to Jerry. Gets up there, the grand play on the part of Walt. Slipping deal, he picks the ball up on the line. And another hand, snap goes to Jerry, putting runners on second and third. Gus Mancuso was purposely passed. Saved being set down for a double play. First is Whitehead, through a walk, forcing Terry across. Jackson, tied deep to DiMaggio, scoring up. Hubble then hit an easy ground ball down second baseway. But Jerry was all set to make the play. Apparently very easy. The ball hit some of that mud or a hole there, bounded over his shoulder for a base hit. Rossetti then picked the ball up, and in attempting to get Whitehead at the plate, he threw Wild. Dickey dashed back, picked the ball up, and tried to get Whitehead through Wild at the plate, permitting Hubble to go to third. And of course, Moore made the point. We're in the ninth inning now, the score 6-1 in favor of the New York Giants.
Jakey Powell is up. A perfect day, three hits and three times at bat. And Hubble's first pitch, blown inside to a right-hand hitter, ball one. Score is 6-1 in favor of the Giants. There's a windup for the next pitch, and Powell grounds the shortstop. There's Bartell's throw to Terry, and Powell is out. Short to first man out in the ninth. Next is Tony Lazzari. No hits in two times as bad. Fan fight, walk one. One out of the ninth. Giants leading 6-1. Boy, and I'm going to look up this fellow Noah when this is over. One man gone, nobody on. There's a windup for the next pitch. And it's in on the inside corner to Lazzari. Belt high for a called strike. Second ball strike is up. Put that screwball in there knee-high to Lazzari. And the count is 2-0. One man out and nobody on in the ninth. Hubble starts his motion for the next pitch. Lazzari bounded a slow one to second base. Whitehead is up with it. Terry has it. And Lazzari is out at first. Two out in the ninth. Some of the doggy customers are moving toward the exit. As George Selkirk comes up. One hit and three times at bat. A home run opening that third inning. That wasn't enough. By five. Hubble raises his arm for the first pitch to Twinkle Toes. A swinging strike. Letter high pitch. George backs out of the batter's box. Pass becoming resembling more or less of a hog wallow. far as the rods in the bag from front of man Cuso. Tucks it back in his hip pocket. Hubble throws the rubber and starts his motion for the next pitch. Here it is. Selkirk also bound for Whitehead. He's rushing in on the ball. There's the toss to Terry. And the ball game is over. No run, no hit, no error in the ninth. Three up and three away. And the Giants win the first game. 6-1. Giants 6 runs, 9 hits, 1 error. The Yankees 1 run, 7 hits, and 2 errors. And there's your old ball game. Giants knock off the Yankees in the first battle of the 1936 World Series. All of the series games will be broadcast this year with the compliments of the Ford and Lincoln Zephyr Dealers of America. And now here's Warren Brown.
Well, Ty, it was a good game while it lasted. And it lasted, I should say, up until that goofy 8th inning when the Yankees sort of fell apart and blew themselves to 4 giant runs that made this game become more or less of a joke towards its close. Up until then, I regard the game as one of the most remarkable that's ever been played in the World Series because of what we might call the track conditions. This has been, beyond a doubt, the wettest World Series game since the last one of the 1925 World Series played at Pittsburgh. Then I think there was a little more water, but I doubt if it could have been any more uncomfortable for players and fans alike than this game today. Under the circumstances in which the game was played, the pitching of both Hubble and Red Ruffing was remarkable. Both of them kept control, which was a strange thing because of the fact that the ball was slippery. Another remarkable thing was the fact that there was only one error made up until the time in the 8th inning when the Yankees began to go in for wholesale error making. And that one was more or less excusable. It was made by Hubble when he came in fast for a bunt and sort of overran it. The pitchers both had fine control up until the 8th inning when Ruffing allowed one base on balls that hurt him. That was one that passed the runner across the base was given when the bases were filled. Up until then, up until the 8th inning, it was almost anybody's ball game. Selkirk's home run started the Yankees off in the lead, and Bartell's home run tied it. After that, Ruffing's difficulty was that he couldn't stop the power of the Giants. That is to say, Ott, Terry, and Mancuso were able to hit him. Hubble, after he was hit for that one home run by Selkirk, had no particular trouble in keeping Gehrig, DiMaggio, and Dickey quiet all afternoon. And the only time he needed any help, Burgess Whitehead came to his relief with the greatest fielding play of the series when he made a double play on a low line drive hit by DiMaggio and relieved Hubble the only time that Carl asked for any quarter from anybody. Here it is, Ty.
Thank you, Warren Brown. Tomorrow afternoon, beginning at 1:15, the second World Series game will be broadcast over this same station by the Ford and Lincoln Zephyr Dealers of America. Don't miss it. And in the meantime, watch the Fords go by. Well, that, radio friends, is our story for the afternoon. You've heard the play-by-play description of the first game of the 1936 Blue Ribbon Classic. It started at 1:15. Ty Tyson said good afternoon to you. The second game will be played here at the Polo Grounds tomorrow afternoon, and we'll be on the air at 1:15. The first half of the play-by-play this afternoon, presented by yours truly, Tom Manning of Cleveland. The second half of the game by Ty Tyson of Detroit, and we were ably assisted this afternoon by the expert advice of that nationally famous baseball authority, Warren Brown of Chicago. We'll be with you again tomorrow afternoon. This concludes the first broadcast of the World Series. It came to you through the facilities of the National Broadcasting Company.
We wish to thank the American Home Products Company, Procter & Gamble, and the Marrow Manufacturing Company for their courtesy in relinquishing their broadcast periods of most of these stations this afternoon in order that we could bring you the description of the World Series baseball game. The Octanol Ma Perkins program, usually heard at 3:15, will be presented at 4:45 o'clock instead.